This is a replica of the Golden Hind, once captained by the legendary Sir Francis Drake. Graceful and majestic, the Golden Hind is a living link to a bygone age of adventure, which has inspired countless tales of privateers and Spanish gold. But the truth is often more bizarre than the strangest fiction. It was in ships like these that the English pirate adventurers such as Drake and Hawkins preyed upon the vital bullion convoys en route to Spain from the New World, disrupting Spanish trade and weakening her grip on the Low Countries. These were the men who precipitated the conflict between England and Spain, which was to produce one of the most famous engagements in naval history, the defeat of the Spanish Armada. The Mary Rose was the best primary source for the navies of the Tudor and Elizabethan periods. There is much to learn from the surviving artifacts of the Mary Rose, but during her long wait on the floor of the sea, much precious evidence was lost forever.
When the Mary Rose sank on the seabed, she settled into the mud and then very, very quickly filled up with sediment. And it was the starboard side of the ship that was completely covered under the mud with the sediment. And so that survived, preserved under the mud, whereas almost the whole of the port side was eaten away by marine organisms, by worms and mollusks. And so the port side didn't survive, and it was the starboard side that survived so well under the mud that we show to the public today.
Well, the Mary Rose is the first warship that we have available to study. She was purpose-built as a warship. She was built with gun ports in a hull built of tight-fitting carvel planks, so it was a new shipbuilding tradition which arose as a result of the invention of the gunport lid, which concealed tightly a gunport. So if the Mary Rose gun crews had been quick enough and pulled the guns in and shut the lids, maybe the Mary Rose would not have sunk and we wouldn't have this marvelous treasure of information that we have. But as far as shipbuilding techniques are concerned, excavation of the Mary Rose is the only way we can learn about it, because we have no drawings, we have no models, we have no plans until really the time of the Armada. So for a ship which is the precursor to the Elizabethan galleon, really archaeology is the only way of doing it. So the excavation of the Mary Rose, and in fact the raising of the Mary Rose and the study of the structure within the ship hall, is the only way we can learn about this shipbuilding technique that then went on to build, you know, the British Navy, which was the foremost in the world.
The methods used to raise the Mary Rose really were exceedingly clever. She was very, very difficult to raise because she was so fragile, and there were a number of items that contributed to the successful salvage. The real problem with raising the Mary Rose was we just had half a ship, and because of that, it didn't have the structural strength. It's been likened to raising a petal from through the water, and this was one of the most difficult things that we had to overcome. The next thing is that because she was waterlogged, when you actually bring something like that through the water to air interface, they suddenly become about 7 or 8 times heavier than before, because they're no longer held up by the buoyancy of the water. One of the most important things was that she had to be transferred underwater from where she was lying in the seabed into a cradle, so that for the final lift into air, when the timbers become much heavier, she was actually supported both from below and from above. Another extremely important part was that the first piece of raising to overcome the suction was actually done over a number of hours. That meant that part of the lift, when she's very, very susceptible to extra pressures, was done extremely carefully and slowly. Perhaps the most important thing that we found out about the last few moments of battle when we excavated the ship was that the guns were actually still sticking out of the gun ports. It was tremendously exciting diving in the ship once we'd emptied it of all the mud and all the contents, and actually seeing these guns sticking out through the gun ports with the gun port lids still open. And that shows that the water will have come in very quickly when the ship heeled over. And it confirms the account of one of the survivors that said that she heeled over in the wind and the gun ports had been left open. The French had claimed that they sunk her through gunfire, but we didn't find any evidence of French shot on the starboard side of the ship when we raised her. So it sounds as though it may be that it was mishandling rather than gunfire.
With the recent advances in digital technology, we are able to recreate for the first time in 450 years how the Mary Rose may have looked as she sailed into the English Channel on that fateful day in 1544. The Mary Rose had been in service for some years, having been built at the beginning of the 16th century as the pride of Henry VIII's fleet. She was used in Henry's war against France, firing devastating shots on French vessels, aimed from 15 heavy guns located through ports. Sir Edward Howard, Henry's Admiral of the Sea during the Mary Rose's early years, described her to the King as "your good ship, the flower I trow of all ships that ever sailed."
The Mary Rose was built in 1509, or she was started in 1509, and probably engaged first in 1512 in the First War with France. She was built in Portsmouth at the specific request of Henry VIII. Two ships had their keels laid down in 1509, the Mary Rose and what is termed her sister ship, the Peter Pomegranate. The Mary Rose for some time was the largest ship within the fleet at then 450 tons, but by the time she sank, she was actually the second largest, having been upgraded to 700 tons. She was actually built in Portsmouth, probably close to the earliest dry dock in the world, which was built in 1495, or certainly the oldest one in England, which is very close to where she can be seen now in her ship hall.
We're pretty sure that the Mary Rose was built of green oak. This was much easier to fashion with the tools that the Tudor shipwrights had at hand. And what's particularly interesting is that in the time of the Mary Rose, they used a lot of compass timber. Things like this timber that I'm sitting on here, it's actually almost carved with an axe and an adze out of the curved timbers of the ship. And this gave a particularly strong join. Rather than joining two timbers together, they'd carve things out of one timber so that they got the maximum strength in the timber.
The Mary Rose had a main battery of heavy guns mounted on the main deck and on the upper deck in the waist. They're a mixture of bronze guns, which are muzzle loading, and an old design of wrought iron guns. For shorter range weapons, there are wrought iron swivel guns and small hail shot pieces or murderers, which are used to repel boarders.
The damage the Mary Rose could inflict with her artillery meant that the French had to retire. The whole nature of war at sea was changing. In the past, ships were designed to convey troops to land to do battle. Now, the ship itself was developing into a weapon that needed manning by the crew. By 1527, she had seen 16 years of service, and a refit was long overdue. But the Mary Rose would have to wait, and it was not until 1536 that the rebuilding would begin. Henry VIII had begun his reformation of the English Church and in turn made enemies of France and Italy. England needed to brace herself for conflict, and the Royal Fleet was the first line of defense. By 1539, the Mary Rose was complete, weighing in at 700 tons and measuring 37.3 meters at the waterline. In 1545, the Mary Rose joined the Royal Fleet, which was gathering at Portsmouth to repel the French fleet of over 200 ships, amassed to take the Isle of Wight. The first day of battle passed without amazing incidents, apart from small exchanges of fire. Little did the English suspect when July 19th, 1545 dawned that their loss would be so huge. During French fire, the Mary Rose just keeled over and sank. The French claimed a victory, but in fact, the Mary Rose was out of firing distance. The eyewitness accounts vary, but some claim her lowest gun ports, which were open for battle, were too close to the waterline. But archaeological evidence suggests there was a decent clearance. There were also reports of indiscipline on the ship, so a simple sailing error could have occurred. But whatever the reason, once water entered the gun ports, it was all over.
The actual cause is still slightly uncertain. The only survivor's account was from a Flemish crew member of the ship who said that she was turning after being fired one broadside. They hadn't closed the gun ports. She was caught by wind. As she heeled over, the water came in through the gun ports and she sank very rapidly. Out of a crew of between 400 and 500, only somewhere between 20 and 40 men survived.
When the Mary Rose foundered in 1545, a covering of silt meant that the wreck was exceptionally well preserved for 450 years, until she was brought to the surface in the 1980s to reveal a spectacular insight into life aboard a 16th century sailing ship and her construction. But Henry's misfortune has turned to our advantage, as we are fortunate today in that one major example of the wreck of a 16th century warship remains for study by historians.
Actually, a 16th century warship is bigger than one would expect. The height between decks is nearly 2 meters, and if you compare that with Victory, where everybody had to go round crouching, it actually probably would have been more comfortable, at least for walking around. And when you bear in mind that some of our human remains are between 5'8" and 5'10", they weren't small people, so this myth about all 16th century people being small isn't true.
Throughout most of her career, the Mary Rose had a crew of 415 men, roughly 50-50 soldiers and sailors, with about 30 gunners on board. The commander of the ship was normally the captain, although on the day she sank, she actually had the vice admiral on board as well. Beneath the captain, there'd be a series of other officers, including a master, who was really in charge of the sailing of the ship, and craftsmen like carpenters, pilots, barber surgeon, and of course the ordinary sailors.
The Mary Rose is only 32 to 35 meters long. We have no evidence of bunks on board, so people obviously just slept by the guns. We certainly haven't got any hammocks because they weren't within the English Navy at the time. And so the conditions must have been fairly cramped. It would have been dark because although we did have lanterns on board, during the engagement, the only place that had a lantern was the galley and then, oddly enough, the carpenter's cabin, although one would have expected the barber surgeon to have a lantern lit. It wasn't, and all the others were in storage in the hold, probably for the safety reasons of keeping a lighted match on board.
The diet of Elizabethan sailors was not equivalent to today's hygienically prepared meals. In the days before refrigeration, the problem of food storage was a never-ending headache for the sailors. But the Mary Rose find suggests that there were at least some fresh fruit to vary the diet of salted meat.
The food wasn't bad. It was mostly composed of beef, beer, and ship's biscuit or bread. Each sailor got a gallon of beer a day. And we're talking about between 1 and 2 pounds of beef per person per day. So it was a fairly high protein diet, and fairly monotonous, but it seemed to have kept them alive quite well.
This is a mock-up of one of the gun decks on the Mary Rose, and it gives a very good idea of what it would have been like on a 16th century warship. The experience of the Armada campaign was very different for the Spanish and the English. The English suffered perhaps 100 casualties during the whole campaign. There was very little damage done to their ships during all of the battles. They would have been hauling cannon like this inboard, reloading them, hauling them back out as fast as they possibly could. The Spanish, on the other hand, would have found the process very frustrating. They were expecting to fight hand to hand. Cannonballs striking a ship like this would send wood splinters hurling across the ship. A person being hit by that would be cut in two. The injuries suffered were hideous. Some Spanish ships were said to be running at their gun ports with blood. The medical facilities were very poor on any ship of the period, and in battle they were immediately overwhelmed by the number of casualties. The basic principle that doctors worked on at the time was that if the wound was in a limb, it was simply cut off. If the wound was in the main part of the body, then you were going to die anyway, so you were simply put to one side and forgotten about.
Today, the hull is sprayed constantly with a special blend of chemicals to preserve from further decay the timbers which lay so long at the bottom of the ocean. Even in her heyday, the below decks area of the Mary Rose would have always been damp. In rough seas, water pouring over the decks would have poured into the gun decks, and the crew had to live and sleep in wet clothes.
Keeping warm and dry was very difficult for a Tudor sailor. They almost certainly didn't carry much in the way of spare clothes, The only heating on board would be from the galley fires, and even those wouldn't be lit in high seas. Fortunately, the fleet didn't tend to fight during winter.
Alongside the timbers of the Mary Rose was also found a large treasure trove of artifacts from a 16th century navy, which has given us a unique insight into war at sea during the reign of Henry VIII. The Tudor navy existed at a time of transition in warfare. Cannon were now an accepted form of armament for a ship. But the soldiers who were brought on board in anticipation of hand-to-hand fighting were still equipped with longbows.
The English had a tradition of using the longbow in war, and even though handguns were making a major impact on the rest of the European scene, the English still carried on with their longbow far later than anybody else did.
Despite their purposeful look, the ability of sailing ships to bring about a successful battle is dependent on a large number of factors. However majestic these vessels were, they were entirely dependent upon the direction of the wind, and literally could only sail according to which direction the wind was blowing.
The crucial thing in naval warfare of this period was the wind gauge. If you had the wind behind you, you could choose where to go because the wind would blow you there. If you didn't have the wind gauge, you had a problem. Sailing ships cannot sail directly into the wind. What they can do is they can sail across the wind, which is called tacking. And so you can make headway into the wind by sailing in diagonals roughly towards it. The English ships were very good at sailing close to the wind. That's where the expression close to the wind comes from. And the Spanish were mystified as how the English were able to gain the wind gauge of them. Simply, it seemed, by sailing to almost any quarter of the wind that they wanted to. And that was to play a major part in the battle, because essentially, the English didn't want to close with the Spanish, they didn't want to fight hand to hand, and being able to take the wind gauge when they chose, being able to sail close to the wind, enabled the English to choose when the actions occurred.
The ships which carried the Spanish Armada in 1588 were very similar in design and construction to those of the English fleet. They differed only in one crucial area of construction. Since medieval times, warships had been built with a high tower in the front of the ship, known as the forecastle. In the medieval era, warfare at sea was very much about coming to grips with the enemy at close quarters and fighting it out hand to hand. So the height advantage, which came from a high forecastle, was a distinct advantage. By 1588, the English ships had come to rely much more heavily than other nations on the new technology of gunpowder, which meant the ships could fight at a distance. By dispensing with the ungainly forecastle, the English ships of the Armada period exchanged hand-to-hand fighting ability for maneuverability. They intended to use the superior gunning skills to fight at a distance, only closing to hand-to-hand distance for the final kill. These were the tactics which Drake would successfully adopt during the battle with the Armada.
There were about 24 frontline warships in the English fleet and about the same number in the Spanish fleet. And these were the ships that would actually do the bulk of the fighting. The big legend about the Armada is that the Spanish ships were very large and that the English ships were very small. Now that's true in as much as Spanish ships were built high. They had very high castles at the front and back of the ship. This is because the Spanish again were aiming to fight hand to hand, and being up high in a hand to hand fight was a big advantage. Because the English weren't going to fight hand to hand, they didn't need that advantage. So they built their ships low. They were interested in speed, they were interested in maneuverability, and they were interested in a long ship which could have a lot of guns along its flank.
Tudor warships weren't particularly fast, certainly under 10 knots. Speed could be a decisive factor in the battle, as could maneuverability. This applied, of course, particularly when sailing ships came up against the galleys, which in the calm could obviously outmaneuver them and were much faster.
The story of the Armada is inextricably linked to the story of the ships which sailed against it and the men who sailed in them. For all of the great events which it witnessed, a ship like the Golden Hind is remarkable for just how small it is. To modern eyes, used to the sight of supertankers, the Golden Hind is a tiny vessel. Only 88 feet in total length, the Golden Hind was a cramped home to a crew of 85 men. It was a ship exactly like this which took Drake and his men round the world. It took them to North and South America and carried them into a host of hair-raising adventures under the very nose of the King of Spain. Compared to the great wooden ships of Nelson's navy, the Golden Hind carried a relatively small complement of guns, arranged on a single gun deck, but by the standards of the day, was considered to be a powerful warship, particularly in the right hands and with the right crew. In keeping with the small size of the ship, the crew was fairly compact for most ordinary voyages. However, in times of war, the number of men packed into the claustrophobic decks of a ship like the Golden Hind would rise dramatically. In the summer of 1588, the war between England and Spain had reached a crucial point. A Spanish invasion fleet of 128 ships was approaching the English coast. Of these, 24 were first-rate warships, the mighty Spanish galleons of legend. The others ranged in size and design, but were all expected to give a good account of themselves in battle. Against this mighty armada were ranged the stout-hearted English seamen under Drake, Frobisher, and Hawkins.
Drake was the most famous Englishman of his time. He was quite possibly the most famous commoner in the world by 1588. He had circumnavigated the globe, the first Englishman to do so. He had launched the highly successful raid on Cadiz in 1587, at which preparations for the Armada were completely scotched for a whole year. His fame was really worldwide. He was certainly well known to everyone who sailed in the Spanish navies. He was believed to have a magic mirror which told him the location of every ship in the world. And that is why Drake always mysteriously turned up when a Spanish treasure ship was on the seas.
The Spanish king, Philip II, had wisely decided not to embark his entire army for the invasion of England from Spain. Instead, he chose to send a very strong naval force with comparatively few soldiers on board to rendezvous with the Spanish army waiting in Flanders. The fleet from Spain would then escort the army safely over the short crossing to England, keeping them company at sea for only the minimum amount of time necessary. Under this plan, the Spanish general in Flanders would have the relatively simple task of bringing together a large fleet of small, flat-bottomed craft to make the short crossing of the Channel under the protection of the armada sent from Spain. On the 9th of May, 1588, orders were finally given for the Armada to set sail from Lisbon and begin its slow progress up the coast towards England. The Spaniards were under the command of the Duke of Medina Sidonia, who was a brave and proven soldier, but a less than capable admiral, as events were to prove. Despite previous experience at sea, he suffered constantly from seasickness, which often incapacitated him at crucial moments. A far from ideal situation.
The Duke of Medina Sidonia was chosen for three reasons. First of all, because he was a first-rank Spanish grandee. That meant that the other nobility who were going to take part in the Armada expedition would naturally take his orders no matter what they were. Secondly, he was an extremely wealthy man, although much in debt at the time, and he could be expected to spend some of his own money helping to pay for the Armada preparations. Thirdly, Medina Sidonia did have considerable knowledge of organising naval expeditions. He had been in charge of preparing the Indies fleet, which brought treasure back from South America. So he was a man who knew about provisioning fleets and had considerable experience of getting them to sea.
One factor which lay totally outside Medina Sidonia's control was the weather, which was very unkind to the Armada. Poor winds meant that the ships made very slow progress indeed. In fact, during the first 13 days at sea, the Armada had covered only 161 sea miles, leaving the fleet still short of the coast of England, 50 miles south of the Isle of Wight. From there, Sidonia sent a fast ship to the king, keeping him updated of his progress and of his plans to rendezvous with the army waiting in Flanders under the command of the Prince of Parma. At this crucial juncture, Sidonia began to have doubts about Parma's readiness to join him in the invasion of England. Less than confident of his fleet's seaworthiness, Sidonia did not want to venture too near the coast of Flanders, and made this profoundly clear in his letter to the king.
I am obliged to proceed slowly, with all the Armada together, in squadrons, as far as the Isle of Wight, and no further, until I receive advices of the Duke of Parma informing me of the condition of his force. As all along the coast of Flanders there is no harbour or shelter for our ships, if I were to go from the Isle of Wight thither with the Armada, our vessels might be driven onto the shoals, where they would certainly be lost. In order to avoid so obvious a peril, I have decided to stay off the Isle of Wight until I learn what the Duke is doing, as the plan is that at the moment of my arrival he should sally with his fleet without causing me to wait a minute. The whole success of the undertaking depends upon this.
In 1585, Drake had led an infamous raid on the Spanish coast, which led to the capture of the port of Cadiz in an incident which became notorious as singeing the King of Spain's beard. During this raid, Drake had taken care to destroy a great quantity of seasoned barrel staves, which had been earmarked for making barrels for storage of gunpowder and provisions for the Armada. To confound the problems for the Admiral, it was discovered that much of the provisions taken aboard had already spoiled and were unfit to eat. In addition, many ships were already short of water due to the destruction by Drake of the Spanish water barrels. In their rush to replace the barrel staves destroyed by Drake, the Spaniards had been forced to make new barrels from unseasoned wood. It was these barrels which shrank and split, allowing the supplies to rot. Despite the problems of supply, the Spaniards began to make some headway, and on 29th July 1588, Captain Thomas Fleming, aboard the Golden Hind, brought the long-awaited news of the Armada's approach to the English fleet at Plymouth. Immediately, the English ships under Lord Howard of Effingham began to prepare for battle. At this point, one of the legendary moments in history supposedly occurred. When Drake was informed of the approach of the Armada, legend has it that he insisted on first finishing his game of bowls, so confident was he of defeating his opponent at his leisure. He felt there was ample time to finish the game before he finished the Spaniards. Apocryphal or not, it makes for a wonderful picture of calm before the storm.
Drake is supposed to have stopped his fellow captains from rushing down to the port by saying that they had time to finish their game and still beat the Spanish. Now, there is no contemporary record of that actually happening, although the first written record does occur within the possible lifespan of someone who might have been there. So it is possible that something like that did happen.
Whatever Drake may have done, in reality there is no dispute that the first contact between the two fleets came on 31st of July. The English sailors were overawed by the sheer scale of the Spanish fleet. Sailing in a huge crescent formation up the English Channel were some 128 warships and galleys. Around this huge formation, the English ships exhibited extreme caution.
The Spanish had developed on the basis of galley warfare in the Mediterranean, where they'd been very successful. So they form a formation which is really more of an arrowhead, although the English see it from behind as a crescent. And what they're looking to do is they're expecting the English to be in front of them, blocking the channel. So they have their ships side by side, and they're intending to sail up to the English, fire one broadside, close in, grapple, and board.
Setting aside his concerns, Sidonia arranged his fleet into battle formation. The famous crest shape made excellent sense for a battle of shipboarding engagements, as it allowed vessels to join a battle at the most advantageous points according to how each captain viewed the preceding events. But in this instance, the English fleet had no intention of coming to groups.
The first thing that happens in the Armada is that the Spanish approach and the English fleet sails round them. This is very confusing for the Spanish because they obviously are aiming to sail up the channel and they expect the English to try and stop them. But the English have suddenly gone to a lot of trouble to get behind them. What the English are looking to do is close in and use their ship-smashing guns. Now, they have some problem with the Spanish formation because if they try and attack the weakest ships of the Armada, which are inside the arrowhead, then they are in grave danger of being overwhelmed by the closing wings of the crescent, in which case they would be involved in boarding, and they have no chance if the ships come close together because the English ships don't have troops on them. They cannot fight hand to hand.
As they had far superior numbers of soldiers on board, the Spanish were very keen to come to grips with the English at close quarters. But the English fleet managed to stay out of grappling range, where Drake and Howard were able to engage the Spaniards in a long-range gunnery duel, in which the English would always have the advantage. As the two fleets could not come to grips, the fighting was very much reduced to that of a series of skirmishes. English shipboard guns were technologically superior to the Spanish ones, and consequently a lot faster to reload. In addition, English gunpowder was better manufactured as well. And so, when it actually came to a cannon firefight, although the English ships were similar in size, they could throw far greater weight of metal against the Spanish. Despite this success, and the fact that they inflicted severe damage to the Spanish on the way up the channel, they were never able to cripple the Spanish fleet.
There aren't very many accounts of ships being sunk by gunfire. The guns weren't that accurate, for starters. Most ships surrender when enough of the crew have been killed, rather than actually destroyed by gunfire.
The battleship Rosario was sufficiently damaged that it had to be left behind by the progress of the fleet. Next morning, she was captured by Drake, whose fearsome reputation caused the Spanish to surrender without a fight. Again, we are fortunate that a contemporary description of the action has survived.
Drake summons the captain, Pedro de Valdez, who refuses to surrender. He is then asked aboard the English ship, the Revenge, and he is introduced to Drake. He asks for a few moments to consider and then comes back and promptly surrenders to Drake without fighting. This is exactly the power of Drake's legend of his hold over the Spanish. It's inconceivable that Valdez would have surrendered to anybody else, but as soon as Drake's name is mentioned, he gives up without a struggle.
The San Salvador was the next Spanish galleon to be abandoned and fell prize to Tom Fleming and the Golden Hind. Despite these losses, the Armada proceeded up the channel. Medina Sidonia was now painfully aware that his provisions and ammunition were very low. He feared he might now be attacked by what was now obviously a far superior English force, and one which was much better supplied from its home ports. His urgent letter to the King of Spain has survived and paints a vivid portrait of his concerns.
We are much inferior in strength to our enemy, according to the opinion of all those competent to judge. Many of our largest ships are still missing, as well as two of the galleys. Whilst on the ships that are here, there are many sick, whose number will increase in consequence of the bad provisions. These are not only very bad, as I have constantly reported, but they are also scanty, that they cannot be more than sufficient to last 2 months. By this, your Majesty may judge whether we can proceed on the voyage, upon the success of which so much depends. Your Majesty has embarked in this expedition all your resources, both in ships and warlike stores, and I can see no means whatever of redressing any disaster that may befall us.
In addition to the King, Sidonia was also sending urgent letters to the Duke of Parma, in command of the Spanish in Flanders. He could get no reply to the various messages he sent to Parma in Flanders, which only added to his unease. As the wind swung round, for once in his favor, he took a decision to seek safety in the port of Calais. It was to prove a disastrous choice. A surviving letter from Sidonia to Parma makes his nervousness very clear to us.
I have constantly written to your Excellency, giving you information as to my whereabouts with the Armada, and I not only have I received no reply to my letters, but no acknowledgement of their receipt has reached me. I am now extremely anxious at this, as your Excellency may imagine, and to free myself of the doubt as to whether any of the messages has reached you safely, I am now dispatching this flyboat with the intelligence that I am at anchor here, 2 leagues from Calais, with all the Armada, the enemy's fleet being on my flank and able to bombard me, whilst I am not in a position to do him much harm. I feel obliged to inform your Excellency of this, and to beseech you, if you cannot at once bring out all your fleet, to send me the 40 or 50 flyboats that I asked for yesterday, as with this aid, I shall be able to resist the enemy's fleet until your Excellency can come out with the rest, and we can go together and take some port where this armada may enter in safety.
History does not record whether Sidonia received the reply he expected from Parma, but he certainly did not receive the extra warships he asked for. No sooner had the Spanish fleet entered the harbor at Calais than they were effectively besieged by the English ships, which dropped anchor and waited events. The French at this stage were supposedly neutral, but there was genuine concern among the English fleet that they would resupply the Armada. In order to prevent this, the English decided that they would launch an attack with fireships against the Spanish vessels in the harbor. On the eve of 7th August, 8 burning English ships were carried towards the Spanish fleet on the rising tide. Their cannons were loaded with double shot, which would fire indiscriminately once the flames reached the guns. Although no Spanish ships were actually set alight by the burning vessels, many of the Spanish ships collided with each other in their efforts to flee the harbor, and the fleet was scattered into the night. The attack of the fire fleets was to prove a huge setback for the Armada, and in reality was the turning point of the whole campaign. However, even if Sidonia had succeeded in reaching his rendezvous with the army of Flanders, there is a great deal of evidence to suggest that Parma was still unprepared and could not have made the crossing on any account.
The Spanish were intending to land Cape Margate in the Thames estuary. Parma would have found his way to London blocked by the River Medway. So the question really resolves on whether the army at Tilbury would have been able to cross the bridge of boats that they were building and get behind the line of the Medway to block Parma's advance. If this had happened, Parma would have found it very difficult to cross such a wide river while being opposed by even militia forces. He would therefore probably have to have turned south to manoeuvre around the Medway, when he would have exposed his flank to the Tilbury army and met the force that was marching up the coast head on.
Inspectors sent by the king told a very different tale from the confident Prince of Parma. They confirmed to the king that the army of Flanders was in no state to invade, that the army had not embarked, and that insufficient boats were available to transport them in any case. An indignant letter from Parma, protesting against their view, has survived.
The men who have recently come hither from the Duke, not seeing the boats armed or with any artillery on board, and the men not shipped, have been trying to make out that we are not ready. They are in error. The boats are, and have been for months, in proper condition for the task they have to effect, namely to take men across. Although we have not as many seamen as we ought to have. Still, withal, we have sufficient for the work we have to do. The boats are so small, it is impossible to keep the troops on board of them for long. There is no room to turn around, and they would certainly fall ill, rot, and die. The putting of these men on board these low, small boats is done in very short time. This wind would prevent our boats coming out, even if the sea were clear of the enemy ships.
Whatever the condition of Parma's men, the Armada had recovered its cohesion after the attack of the fireships, and now began its laborious progress once more. With the English now fully aware of the direction of the Armada, the additional English fleet, which had been covering the approach to Dover, was able to join the ships commanded by Drake. Once the fleet was again underway, the Spanish galleons were again dogged by incessant English attacks, which buzzed around the lumbering galleons like so many fast stinging hornets. In addition to ready supplies from their home ports, the English also had the advantage of extra numbers.
The English now know that they have got to make their shots count. They've been joined by Seymour's squadron, which has been protecting the Straits of Dover, so they have 35 additional ships. Drake has honed his tactics in the run up the channel. They're going in very close. We know that they're fighting within musket shot. The Spanish are running low on ammunition for some of their guns. They are tired, they've been at sea a long time. The weather is changing. Squalls disrupt their formations. They manage to get about 24 ships together to form a line of battle. But the English are determined not to let them get away again. So the English go in very close, they blast away, they turn, they come back again, they blast again. Spanish tactics simply can't cope with this. They're being blown apart, and there's really nothing they can do about it.
To confound the Spanish distress, no extra supplies had been forthcoming from the French in Calais, and many of the Spanish ships were so low on ammunition they could barely resist the English attacks. In many cases, their stocks of gunpowder were completely exhausted, so the great guns could not be fired, leaving the ships defenseless. The English were quick to capitalize on the situation. It was now that Medina realized that the invasion of England could not possibly be attempted. His decision was supported by Parma on shore, who was concerned by the thorough plans laid for the land resistance in England.
The enemy have thereby been forewarned, and are acquainted with our plans, and have made all the preparations for their defense, so that it is manifest that the enterprise, which at one time was so easy and safe, can now only be carried out with infinitely greater difficulty and at much larger expenditure of blood and trouble.
It was now time for the Spanish fleet to turn for home. But even after Sidonia had taken the decision not to rendezvous with the army of Flanders, bad luck continued to dog his steps. Faced with prevailing winds, which continued to blow against his favored direction of travel, he was left with the only alternative of sailing the fleet completely round British Isles and home to Spain.
The Armada is running north towards Scotland. They hold a council of war and they decide that when possible they will return to the Channel to renew the fight. But the weather won't let them. They end up north of Scotland and they decide that the only option is to head home, going entirely round the British Isles.
Unfortunately, the problem they had was the lack of proper charts. The science of cartography was still in its infancy. The Spanish maps didn't show just how far Ireland projected into the Atlantic. Every ship was to make its own speed and follow its own course. The ships that were still relatively well supplied and undamaged could afford to head well out into the Atlantic and managed to get home quite safely. Many of the ships which had been battered in the fighting were also running dangerously low on supplies. In addition, many were carrying horses, which had been consuming a lot of the available water. It was ships like these who decided to stay close to the coast of Ireland and not to make a much longer detour. The appalling weather and rough seas along an uncharted coast led to many wrecks along the west coast of Ireland.
The English had a very small garrison in Ireland. They were aware that the Armada had at least 16,000 soldiers with it. They were extremely worried that if anything like a large proportion of this land in Ireland, that there would be a revolt by the native Irish. They react with extreme brutality, and many of the Spanish survivors of the wrecks are murdered out of hand by the English garrison.
It was the fateful decision to sail round Britain, which had proved to be the lasting public impression of the Armada. Although very few ships were actually lost in battle against the English fleet, dozens of Spanish craft were wrecked in the terrible storms which blighted the unseasonable August of 1588. Ultimately, only 65 ships of the 128 which had set sail from Spain would ever see their homelands again. A terrible fate for so many brave men and beautiful craft.
The Armada was an extremely important part of English history, both because the invasion was prevented and also because it established the English as the number one naval nation in Europe. They had proved themselves supreme in technology, in sailing ability. They had proved themselves the masters of Atlantic warfare. And Atlantic warfare was where the future lay. Galley warfare in the Mediterranean had gone on for centuries, but its day was over. Drake had proved that he could destroy galleys in Cadiz harbour. The galleys stood no chance against the sailing ship. Now Drake had proved that the English designed warship was superior to anything that the Spanish or anyone else could put to sea. And that is the foundation of English naval supremacy for the next 300 years.